How much time do I have? I said, like, 10 minutes. And you already had your drone out and you started flying it. And, like, you normal know, person would be, like, really nervous. Like, is he gonna...
You know, you gotta take advantage of every free moment. There's no way this is gonna work. Somebody's gonna get hurt right now. As long as that somebody's not me. Oh my God.
Yes. We have the drone and there.
It is not happy. Wait, hold on, I fucked up.
Oh, this is incredible. But yeah, I've been following this guy for one day now, and it's all true. He does multitasking. Like, he's on top of a race car, he films, he vlogs, he flies the drones. All right, make some noise. Okay, so...
I'm not shooting it! I'm flying in the zone!
There you go.
Well, I gotta get a button to stop.
You guys wanna be in the vlog? Hey, it's your show. You do whatever you want. I can ask questions at the same time. So Casey, before we go to this Q&A, please tell me, who really is Casey Neistat? How would you define yourself?
Is that like an existential question? I don't know.
Well, people have seen your vlogs. You've seen this guy's vlogs. You are a huge hero in Finland.
I think the vlogs are pretty accurate. I cut out most of the stuff where I'm really angry and most of the bad stuff. So I would say the only thing that's really absent from the public persona is, the depth of like the mundane that is life. Like, we all deal with the same kind of bullshit, and it's just not interesting. The benefit that I have is I only have to portray my life in 8-minute segments, so it's easy to edit out the uninteresting bits. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And as I mentioned, it was incredible to follow you yesterday. How do you do it all? Like, vlog, fly the drones, take those B-roll shots?
It's fun. It's like it's the only way to like make sure you're... neurons are firing on all cylinders, is to always be doing as much as you could possibly be doing, like organizing your drone parts. There it is. If I lost this fucking piece, look at how little this thing is.
So, Casey, when you started the daily vlogs, like before that, you already made a lot of YouTube videos, but was that hard to make that transition to do it daily?
More creatively than anything else. I think that prior to going with The Daily Show, I focused on making short movies, and I used YouTube as a distribution outlet for those short movies. And the videos had amassed a really strong following and a good audience, and it was very exciting. But just go ahead and kill this. But it's a very different relationship with the audience, because it was about the movies themselves. They sort of stood alone. And the transition that took place when I switched to daily is it was much more about me. It was much more character driven. So it didn't matter sort of what I was doing that day, whether I was in Helsinki speaking at FOOM, or I was, going to the dentist in New York City. The story was the story of my life. And I think the big shift wasn't the workload, the big shift was in how that changed my relationship with the people who were watching the stuff I was making.
And now you're doing the third season of your vlogs.
Yeah, season three.
So what, like, the amount of workload you do, like you film, you edit, you produce, you come up with all that?
I mean, you do get addicted to it. Like, there's something about, there are a lot of kids here. Why didn't somebody cut me off with all the swearing before?
Finland, it's okay.
Good to know. You get addicted to it. Like, sort of quantifying my progress in life with what I've done and what I've made. And I think there's no greater satisfaction than sort of the dopamine rush that is completing something every day. And I really love that. And I think that was the most exciting part of the doing like a daily vlog for me, was that opportunity. And you know, there are burdens that go along with that, but there's something just hugely exciting about finishing something every single day. And when you stop, you sort of, you lose that sense of accomplishment, and it leaves you wanting. The only thing I can equate it to is running. It's like, I run every day, and if I don't run on a certain day, the day doesn't feel complete. It's as if I didn't accomplish what I sort of defined as a day for myself.
Is it ever like hard to find new ideas, or like where do you get your inspiration from? Like,
I think inspiration is hugely overrated. I don't even like the word inspiration, because I think it's, ideas are like dreams. I think dreams are really stupid. Whenever anybody says to me, you want me to tell you about my dream, or can I tell you about my dream? I say, no, don't, because I don't care. Dreams are dumb. I think dreams only exist for a moment, And in that moment, there's a dream that exists. And in that moment, you decide to either realize it, to do it, or you don't. And if you don't, I don't give a shit about it, because who cares? And if you do, it's no longer a dream, it's a goal. It's something you're doing. It's not something that doesn't exist, it's something you're actually doing. So I do care about what you're doing. I do care about the fact that you've set out to start your own YouTube channel. I do care about the fact that you want to start a business. I do care about the fact that you want to play professional football. I care about that stuff. But if it's just a dream, I don't give a shit, don't waste my time. Like, do it or don't do it. So for me, when it comes to the act of creation, all I care about is the act of doing. And I try to never get hung up on the idea of the idea or the inspiration or the dream.
Well, you truly live that. You do.
Try.
Hey, let's take a few questions from the audience. Okay. Wow.
This is a lively bunch. I have a request before we pick people.
Okay.
Can we please go girl, boy, girl, boy, girl, boy, and then just continue that girl, boy, X chromosome, Y chromosome pattern through the duration of this cute question and answer session?
I think it's the
joke. Okay, great. Okay, great. Great.
I'm boy, so yeah.
Okay, yeah. We're starting off in a good place.
Yeah, well, first of all, thanks for everything you do. You just motivate everyone, you motivate me. And so my question was, you inspire a lot of people, a huge amount of people around the world, but who inspires you? Is there anyone who motivates you?
Sure. You know, as far as creative motivations, there's a number of filmmakers or creators that I look to that I think are really powerful. I also draw from weird places. Like, one of my favorite books in the whole world, I've literally read it 4 times and it's like 800 pages, is a textbook on World War II. It's a book that you read in university, a college textbook on World War II. Because there was something about the tenacity and perseverance of the generals in World War II that I find tremendously motivating. Like, they couldn't stop because they had no choice. And it was literally do or die. And there was something about that that just struck me. And I look to civil rights heroes in the United States of America as people who similarly operated with sort of out of sheer necessity. They realize their dreams and aspirations out of sheer necessity, and I draw a lot from those types. When it comes to filmmakers, you know, I look to people like Spike Jonze and Michel Gondry. I think when I was coming up, they were the heroes of mine because they were making stuff unlike anybody else out there. And there was something tangible about their films that felt like I could do that too. Werner Herzog, German filmmaker. I think his films are great, but I think his ethos and what he represents is far more motivating for me than anything he's ever actually made. The ideas that he represents and the fact that he thinks knowing how to forge a fake film permit is more important than knowing how to use a camera is perfectly aligns with what it is that I love about filmmaking. So I would say it's all over the place, but there isn't one sort of creator that I would point to say, I want to be like that person, I want to be like her. It's, for me, it's more of an aggregate of different ideas that I just love and try to latch myself onto.
Nice. Then do we have a girl here?
So many hands in the air. Okay, over here. Yes.
Hi, Casey.
Hi.
I'm a girl.
And, that's fantastic. You guys are really doing a good job with this girl-boy thing.
My question is, you seem very confident in what you're doing and what you think is the right or a good thing. And I was wondering if you ever question if there's any value in what you do, or like how do you value, or you know that there's value in like your vlogs or something.
Yeah, I mean, look, it's always been the same for me. When I first started making videos when I was a teenager, there was no YouTube, there was no way to upload videos, there wasn't fast enough bandwidth to actually upload the data that was in a video. The way I would show people videos, I would plug my camcorder into a TV. You remember these days, DV cams. I'd plug the camcorder into a TV, just like the way you did it, and I would click play and show it to three people at a time. And what's not changed since then and now is that back then I made things that I thought were good, and now I make things that I think are good. And it makes it really easy to sort of ignore the thumbs down on YouTube or the fuckheads in the comments. It makes it really easy to ignore the noise if the reason why you're making it is for yourself. And if the reason why you're making it is so people will like you and so you can be popular and famous and cool and make money, then you shouldn't be doing it in the first place. And it's typically, I think that's the delineation. And if you're doing it for the right reasons, then the noise around it, the negativity around it, any kind of discouragement just sort of rolls off of you, because that's not why you set out to create.
Thank you. Then we also have questions which have gone through Twitter. Here's a question. Have you, Casey, done any mistakes regarding YouTube? And if, what have you learned from them?
Mistakes on YouTube? I mean, there are certainly some videos that I've posted that I look back at and I wish I hadn't posted. And sometimes they're vlogs and sometimes they're different kinds of videos, but they always have one thing in common, which is I rushed. I didn't stop and really think, is this what I want to put out? And I would say, you know, you're asking about the vlog and creating daily before, and I would say that is one of the negatives of the vlog, and one of the things that in season three I'm really working hard to avoid is you become sort of a slave to clicking that upload button. The daily, it has to be every day at the same time. And I realized there were a number of times when I would sort of sacrifice or compromise the integrity or the way in which I would create so I could get it posted in time. And I look back and I see some subpar work that I wish I had given more focus to. So I think it's more of a relationship with how you create in the process than I would point at any particular video as a regret.
And now you have also mentioned in your vlogs on the third season you're not going to be posting daily. Is this because of, like, you can just give yourself a break at sometimes?
I mean, it's less about giving myself a break, and it's more about making sure I'm doing it for the right reasons. I mean, breaks are nice, but even days when I decide not to make a video, I'm bummed out that I'm not making a video. But at the same time, you know, literally this week, I had a video ready to post at, like, noon. And there was something about it that wasn't right, so I was just like, well, I'm not gonna post it. And I didn't post it until the next day, so I missed 2 days in a row or something like that. And I made a commitment to myself that wouldn't bother me. So it's much more about having a more casual relationship with the cadence of posting than it is about needing a break or anything like that. It just feels like a much more responsible way to create. Because when I look back, I'm not gonna remember hitting the upload time correctly every day. When I look back, I'm gonna judge on the quality of the work.
How do you deal with pressure? Do you feel pressure? You've been doing amazing videos for Samsung, for example. You went to Lapland to film that drone video, which was a huge project. And
yeah, I feel a lot of pressure all the time.
How do you deal with
it? I thrive on pressure. The only time I'm really unhappy is when I don't have like a constant stress in my life.
So it's just like a feeling. It's like a
drug that I have to have. And I think that there are very real negative aspects of that. Just ask Candace. Poor Candace. But no, I need a constant pressure. There's nothing I hate more than relaxation. Vacation and relaxation are my two least favorite things. The idea of sitting around with nothing to do gives me so much anxiety that it makes my head explode. I'm only comfortable when I have a million things in front of me and I'm just racing as fast as I can to accomplish all of them. So I thrive on that, but I do feel pressure and I do feel stress and I'm working on a deadline right now that I had to call and say we're not going to hit that deadline, we need 8 more hours, and that's pressure, and it sucks. But no, I found a way to sort of sublimate that.
What do I say?
Don't make it a profanity. There are young children in this room.
Rakastan sinua. Rakastan sinua.
What does that mean?
You can say it to me.
I want him to whisper I love you into my ear. Okay, yeah, give me something. Come on, give me something for real.
Papara! That's a hockey team.
I feel like I'm just being fucked with right now. Why don't we ask another question?
There you go, sir.
Hi, Casey.
Hi, Diana.
Nice to meet you. What do you not like in the content right now, and what do you wish you could see more?
Sure. Well, I think that there's kind of an interesting thing happening specifically on YouTube right now, which is when you can monetize, whenever money's involved, things get weird. And on YouTube, how it works is the more views and more engagement you get, the more you get paid. And I think what that's done is it's been kind of a race to the bottom, where it's content purely made for eyeballs. Purely made to chase those pennies and cents down instead of the quality or integrity of the content. And I think that's kind of a dangerous thing. And the thing about it that I really don't like is I don't know how to correct that. I don't know what motivates that to correct itself. And I don't know really too many other places where that exists. I think musicians make music because they love it. And they make music and sometimes it's a big hit, and Taylor Swift's song pumps everywhere and she makes a whole bunch of money because of it. And when I think of a lot of feature films and I think of even television, I think that there's no formula that will equal high ratings. But I think on YouTube it's slightly more hackable. I think it's sort of easy to look at lowest common denominator content that gets a lot of views and emulate that. And then that can become, that can sort of set a trend of negativity, and it can bring steer the whole creative culture in a bad direction. So I think these are growing pains. You know, YouTube is the first platform where you can get paid to have your videos and content be viewed. And I think we're gonna see a lot more of that. And I think in the next 5 to 10 years, we're really gonna see kind of a renaissance of filmmaking and creativity because of these outlets.
Casey, how do you see the future of blogging in YouTube?
I don't think it's gonna last. I remember when I started vlogging, I only knew of two daily vloggers, and they were both seen as kind of crazy individuals, Fun for Louie and Ben Brown. And they were great guys, they were friends of mine, and I loved what they did, but they were really outliers in YouTube. Pranks were the trend then, 2 years ago. And I started vlogging, and then I noticed other people were starting vlogging, and I noticed it was this trend that I was a part of. And I remember my very smart friend in the social space, Jerome Jarre, said to me, he was like, vlogging's gonna be the next big thing. And now it is, and everybody's doing it. But I think people are gonna get sick of it just as quickly as they got excited by it. And I think that's gonna happen soon. So I think that the future is going to be something that doesn't look or feel like vlogs are today. Do you guys know David Dobrik? I think I talked about him yesterday. Do you guys watch him at all here? Some guys do. I watch his vlogs, and they're unlike anything else on YouTube. And I think that is the trend that we're gonna see, is we're gonna see some smart innovators doing something that doesn't look or feel like anything else, and maybe they'll call it vlogging, and the entire genre will start to shift in a new, fresh direction. Because it's getting pretty stale right now.
Do you still think that it's important to, like, because Or how do you feel about YouTube algorithm? Because like, YouTube has said like their goal is to just keep the viewers in YouTube, and they was are trying to predict how much is this viewer gonna be watching this content, and that's how they recommend their videos. And so, do you ever think about the algorithm?
I don't. I'm sorry. I don't. And I don't know that. I think anybody who does or thinks they know how to work the algorithm is purely speculating. I think it's dangerous. I think that if you're doing it for those reasons, you're paying too much attention to that kind of thing, then you're there for all of the wrong reasons. I just try to put out the best content I can put out, and if people watch it, great, and if they don't, that's fine too. I'll be crying myself to sleep in the bathroom floor.
Well, probably you haven't been crying that much.
No, I've been doing okay, Liv.
Thank you. Yeah. All right, we still have time for a few questions, one or two.
I'm a big fan of yours. I've been for a few years now. And my question involves your style of filmmaking. I think you really reinvented vlogging and online video in general. So my question is, what do you think is the appeal of your style of filmmaking? Because there really exists established Casey Neistat style of filmmaking.
I think that when I started creating daily vlogs on YouTube, the only people that had made content like that before were much more about the sharing than they were about the act of creating. I mean, literally at the time, you had Zay Frank a few years earlier, and he was the first person to talk into a webcam with jump cuts. Like sitting at a desk talking to a webcam, a style that we're all so familiar with now, we just sort of assume it's been around forever. That was invented by somebody. And vlogging at the time was literally just a point and shoot like this. And there were a few people did it, and they talked into a camera in their hand, and that's all it was. It was nothing more. And when I came in, I'd had over a decade of filmmaking behind me. I'd made two feature films, I'd made a TV show, I'd made hundreds of YouTube videos. And it was always about the act of creating. So I didn't approach daily vlogging as a way to share all the intimacies of my life. So much of the first season was about me kind of explaining the fact that this isn't a diary, but this is an opportunity to create something every day. And I think that merging that sort of mandate with my creative experience, my experience in the filmmaking space, it just sort of yielded something that felt more like a movie every day instead of a journal entry every day. And I think that was new enough and exciting enough to build a big audience. And I also think that it's simple and accessible enough for new, young, inspired or motivated creators to try to do something more like that than do what was done prior.
And one last question. Where's some nice lady who can, or a woman? Or girl.
We have a lady up front with a camera in her right hand.
There she is.
Do you think that there's still a place for new vloggers on YouTube?
I think that there's always a place for the next generation in every format, and especially on YouTube. But I don't think that I think the only way to be sort of the next big thing on YouTube is to do something that's unlike anything else that's out there right now. I have a video that I'm going to make that's in my list of videos to make, and it just literally breaks down in the most detailed way exactly how I make my videos. And I'm going to issue a disclaimer there that's like, if you follow these instructions, you'll make a vlog that looks exactly like mine, and it's a guaranteed way to never build an audience or be successful on YouTube. Because to emulate or copy what somebody else is doing or try to be like somebody else on YouTube guarantees you will not succeed. So I do think there's plenty of room for new up-and-comers in the space, but it requires redefining a space or creating a new genre. I always describe it as like there are 10,000 or more sheep headed in that direction on YouTube. And if you think you can just sort of jump in there and walk with those 10,000 sheep in the same direction and actually stand out, you're mistaken. The only way to stand out is to get out of line, turn around, and go in the opposite direction. And that's what's required to succeed on YouTube.
I think that's a great advice. Thank you, Casey, so much. It's been an honor to have you here.
That's so fun.
Let's give a huge applause to Casey Neistat.
Later.
Okay.